بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear brothers and my sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. This is your brother Abdusalam Abu Hanifa. A question came in the group in regards to has Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam been told about al-ghayb? Does he know the unseen? Has he been given a divine attribute of knowing whatever is going to happen in the future, in his time and now, and also in the future? A person in the group had provided some text from an explanation in English of somebody, I don't know who that is, but he explained that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the full and absolute knowledge about when the hour is going to take place, and also some elements of attributes that only belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the unseen. What this person is saying is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows the unseen and also knows exactly when the hour is going to take place. And when confronted with the other ayat that explained that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't know when the hour is going to happen, the person went again and gave some explanations which from their point of view means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kind of told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the hour is going to happen, but Allah said to Rasulullah, just act like you don't know. But it's kind of like it's a secret deal between Allah and the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why people hold today that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had some extreme privileges in front of by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a messenger of al-Islam. But has this really taken place? Is this a reality? Does Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam know exactly when the hour is going to take place and what's going to happen to him and to other people in the future? This is what the talk of today, bi-idhnillah, shall cover. The very first thing that I want to pinpoint here is the preemptive protection of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in regards to his status. He saw sallallahu alaihi wasallam how the Jews referred to Musa alayhi salam, how the Christians had referred to Jesus, son of Mary, when they said he is part of Allah. Others say that he is Allah, and others say he is just the son of God, as we all know. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to give us a warning. And he said, as reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and also in al-Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya, or Imam At-Tirmidhi alayhi rahmatullah, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "La tutruni kama ataratin nasara ibn Maryam, fa innama ana abduhu, faqulu abdullahi wa rasuluh." Do not exaggerate in overpraising me as the Christians praised the son of Mary, for I am only his subservient, i.e. the abd of Allah. Therefore, call me the subservient of Allah, i.e. Abdullah, and his Rasul and his messenger. And as I said, this is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So there you go, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who doesn't speak out of his own desires, has been commanded to pass this information to us, and that is not to over-exaggerate in praising Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mankind have a tendency to always blow out of proportion anything that they love and they venerate and they respect. For example, if I find somebody who likes a writer or a musician or a football player, and they will talk everything that is absolutely great about this person, exaggerate, emotionalize it, and put it in every context, that anyone who listens to their description would think greatly of this person here. But Al-Islam has explicitly warned us against this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in so many ayat in Al-Quran has told us that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is nothing else but a human being. This is why at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. I am nothing else but a human being like you. But the only difference that is between me and you is that I receive the wahi, the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seals the statement that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is nothing else but a human being like you and me. And by that I mean, he went to the toilet, he did exactly like you would do. He fell sick, he got thirsty, he got cold, and he got hungry. He got fearless, and he got fearsome. Everything that you experience as a human being did happen to him. The idea of over-exaggerating and over-praising Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not something of today. It even started at the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. But it was not the Sahaba. It was their followers and people who came new to Islam. After the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as-sahaba used to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They loved him from everything. So it is just normal that they would speak about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a way that it would give to the other people that have not met Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to think absolutely great about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of such people is Masruq, who is one of the followers, who one day asked our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, and he said, "Hal ra'a Rasulullah Allah?" In the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, when Rasulullah ﷺ was taken, as you know, to Jerusalem and then to the heavens, people later on, when they saw of all this great treatment and wonderful attribute that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon Rasulullah ﷺ, they started thinking, has Rasulullah ﷺ seen Allah face to face? Has he seen him with his eyes or not? Masruq, one of the followers, Tabi'in, went to our mother Aisha, the wife of Rasulullah ﷺ, our mother, and he asked her, has the messenger of Allah ﷺ seen Allah with his eyes? Aisha radiallahu anha says to him, لَقَدْ قَفَّ شَعْرِي مِمَّا قُلْتْ. My hair, like you gave me the goosebumps from what you said. Then she said to him, مَنْ حَدَّثَكَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا أَرَأَى رَبَّهُ فَقَدْ كَذَبْ. Whoever tells you, or preaches to you, or says that Muhammad has seen his Rabb, his Lord, Allah, he has lied. And then she said, radiallahu anha, وَمَنْ حَدَّثَكَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا وَمَنْ حَدَّثَكَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ فَقَدْ كَذَبْ. And whoever tells you that Muhammad knows the Ghayb, the unseen, he has lied. And this hadith is also in Sahih al-Bukhari. So as you can see here from our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, the fact that Rasulullah ﷺ has seen Allah with his eyes didn't take place. Now, has this been final? Actually not. In our heritage, Muslims of Islam or Muslim scholars have differed about the idea or the opinion, has Rasulullah ﷺ seen Allah with his eyes or not? There is a great number of scholars that have gone to the point that Rasulullah ﷺ has seen Allah with his own eyes, i.e. Rasulullah ﷺ knows what Allah looks like. Other scholars, they say, no, he doesn't know that and it is impossible, but he has seen him with the eyes of his heart. Now, of those people, before you jump into conclusion, let me tell you, of those people that have said that Rasulullah ﷺ saw Allah with his eyes is Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal of the Hanbali school of thought. Al-Imam Ahmad and Ibn Abbas, and also Al-Imam al-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah, Al-Qadi Iyad radiallahu anhu, and a great number of scholars have gone to the opinion that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has seen Allah with his eyes, and they mentioned some ayat from the Quran to support their argument. Another great number of scholars, including scholars of today, have said that Rasulullah ﷺ has not seen Allah with his eyes, but saw him with the eyes of his heart, whatever that means. But in any case, what it means is he hasn't seen him with his eyes. This has led the Muslims to go and exaggerate about the status of Rasulullah ﷺ. We will find this disease present until today. For example, some people, since Rasulullah ﷺ has seen Allah with his heart, then they say Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, the great Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Nu'man ibn Bashir alayhi rahmatullah, born in the year 80 of the Hijrah and died in the year 150 radiallahu anhu, and may Allah have lots of mercy upon his soul, in our Christian counting, is he was born in the year 699 and died in the year 767. Anyway, people who follow Imam Abu Hanifa, they claim that Imam Abu Hanifa has seen Allah with his heart while sleeping in his dreams 99 times. And that's why they call him Al-Imam Al-A'zam, the most magnificent Imam ever. This is why it's so difficult today when you speak to people that follow the Hanafi school of thought, when you tell them, oh, this and this, they turn to you and they say, Abu Hanifa didn't know it and you tell me he's wrong. And they would not accept it because to them it's impossible that a man that saw Allah 99 times in his dream would make mistakes or errors and things like that. And this is like a really very, very dangerous statement because it makes our scholars and the Sahaba and everything like saints. We don't say it, but we do treat them as such. Is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam alive now? Is he with us? can he travel around the world to meet up with people as they salute him? I pray in my local Jumu'a here, and every Jumu'a, after Salatul Jumu'a, a bunch of people would stand in a circle and they started chanting some stuff. At first I didn't think much of it, but then I started paying attention, and subhanAllah, they say stuff. So when I ask them, the first imam ran away from me. He said, ask the other one. So I went to the other one. And then I got to know that they stand in that thing there to do Darud Sharif or something like that, is to send their salat on Rasulullah ﷺ. And they think really that Rasulullah ﷺ comes to them and salutes them. And this is one of the belief of the Brilwis. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this it's wrong, because it's really putting Rasulullah ﷺ in a status that he doesn't deserve. Scholars of Islam, including the Sahaba until today, are unanimously agreeing on the fact that Rasulullah ﷺ has died, body like anyone else would die. He is buried in the Hujra, the chamber of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anha on one side and Umar ibn al-Khattab on the other side. Just a side information here, when our mother Aisha radiallahu anha was before the whole problems of Ali and Muawiyah took place, she wanted to be buried near her father and her husband radiallahu anha. But after she has been a cause of the killing of 10,000 Sahabi and Muslimin at that time, she was so really scared and she felt really ashamed for what she did. And she asked not to be buried in the chamber, but only to be buried in Al-Baqi'ah, and which is the graveyard of the people of Al-Madinah. As I said, this is just a side information. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not alive, cannot travel, can do nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treats him like he treats any other person. He is living in Hayat al-Barzakh, just like you and me when we die. He is awaiting the day of resurrection and the day of accountability, Yawm al-Hisab. Now, to speak about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about does he know the unseen, al-Ghayb, and things like that, or he doesn't, and also speak about what we call today the miracles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I want to explain a concept which a lot of people have not been made aware of. This concept is the difference between al-Rasul, which is the messenger, and al-Nabi, wrongly translated to prophet, but I'm going to refer to him al-Nabi. If someone comes to you, now I need to explain this to you so you understand. Al-Rasul is a messenger. Imagine Quraysh, or imagine a group of people that have lived for thousands of years on a belief, and that is Quraysh. They just grew believing that stuff there. And then a man comes to them and tells them, look, what you are believing is wrong. Actually, what you should believe is this one here. Now, the very first thing that comes to mind is, why should I believe you? Who are you? What's the difference between you and me? You're human and I am human. Why should I believe you? Then you will need evidences that what you are saying, or evidence to support what you are saying. Just example like today. If I was to send you to my mother, and I would tell you, go to my mother and ask her to give you 5,000 pounds. And you go just like that. You go to my mother and she says to you, okay, that's my son. But do you think she's going to believe you if she doesn't know you at all? She's not going to believe you and she's not going to give you a pound. However, if I told you, go to my mother and tell her this story. When I was a kid, I did this and I did this and she said that and she said that and she did this. And then you go to my mother and you tell her, look, your son needs 5,000 pounds. And she's going to look at you and you tell her, but your son told me that when he was young, he did this and he did that. And you said this and you said that. And then on that day, you did that and he said this. And then you say, he told me to tell you these stories so that you believe that what I'm telling you is the truth. In which case, my mother would say, yes, that's true, that's what happens. And he had told you these things, so here you go, these are the 5,000 pounds. The same thing happened. A Nabi is the one who has brought those miracles so that we believe the messenger in him. When he came to Quraysh and he told them, believe la ilaha illallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ran so many miracles that no human at that time could perform, so that Quraysh believes that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is truly a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of those great miracles is the knowledge of the unseen. So here, before getting into explaining the unseen, let me tell you what al-ghayb mean. Does it really mean the unseen? Well, actually, it does not mean the unseen. Al-Ghayb, the term Ghaba Yaghibu, and thus the term Al-Ghayba is absence. Al-Ghayb is something that is absent. Because the unseen excludes the unheard of, the unfelt, and all these things. But the absent includes everything. And as the absent goes, there is the absent of the past. For example, your childhood right now is an absent to you. Fir'aun in the past is an absent knowledge to us all. Exactly where you live, so the absent can happen in the past. Al-Ghayb, or the absent, can also happen right now. Example, right now, what your neighbors are doing in their house is absent to you. It's a ghayb to you. You don't know what happens there. So we can also not know what's going on right now. And the absent in the future. What's going to happen in the future? And believe it or not, the three absents hold the same value. The three absents hold the same value. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reported in Al-Quran what took place between Musa and Fir'aun, what took place between Allah and Ash-Shaytan, what took place when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the angels about the creation of Adam and what they said, all that is Al-Ghayb, Ilmul Ghayb, it's the knowledge of the absent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to reveal it to us. Right now, what your heart or what your stomach is doing right inside you is absent to you. You don't know. You can't even feel what your stomach is doing right now. Or when you breathe, what happens to the oxygen inside you? That is also a science of the absent. And what you are going to possess in the future is also an absent knowledge to you. So for us people to believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the messenger, al-Rasul, is a authentic and reliable and truthful source that brings us commands from Allah, Allah sent with him evidences. Of these evidences, the unseen or the absent, I'd call it al-ghayb, the absent. So does Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam know the absent? Well, if we said no, we are wrong. And if we say yes, we are also wrong. So there is an explanation between these two things. Why it is wrong to say that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows the absolute absent, the absolute of al-ghayb, i.e. he knows everything. This is absolutely wrong. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Al-Quran, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ أَيَّانَ يُبْعَثُونَ, which translation is meaning, say, قُلْ, none in the heavens and earth knows the absent except Allah. And they, i.e. whoever in the heavens and the earth, they do not perceive when they will be resurrected. Meaning, if alive you don't know the absent, the unseen, the same thing when you are dead. When you are dead, you also wouldn't know. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ عِنْدِي خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ. This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to tell us, I do not tell you that I have the depositories or the container or the rizq of the people of Allah, that or that I know the absent. لا أعلم قل لا أقول لكم عندي خزائن الله. The خزائن are the wardrobes where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the rizq. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has got absolute knowledge of that, and he says, I don't know the unseen or the absent. In another surah, in Surah Al-A'raf, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in Al-Quran, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet or the Messenger to tell us, قل, say, يا محمد, لا أملك لنفسي نفعا ولا ضرا. I do not possess for myself or hold for myself the power of the harm or the good, i.e. I cannot run my destiny. I just want the good for me or the bad for me. I have absolutely no power of what happens to me. إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ, except what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wanted to happen to me, that shall happen. And then he runs the hypothesis, وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ, and if I were to know the absent, the unseen of the future, لَسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ, I certainly would have gathered a lot of much wealth and a lot of much good, and i.e. I would have surrounded myself with every element of positivity. For example, today your children, you educate them in a certain way. But if you knew what would the future hold for you, you wouldn't educate them like you're educating them today, because you know that the education of today does not work in the future. This is exactly what Rasulullah is saying. If I knew the absence of the future, I would have done things differently to avoid the evil to take place in the future. وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءُ. Exactly what I've said. And no evil would have touched me, because I would know what was going to happen and I would have planned my life accordingly to avoid the evil. In أَنَا. But I am only a human being like you. إِلَّا نَذِيرٌ وَبَشِيرٌ. I am nothing but a warner and a bringer of good news to a people who believe. So here the Quran explicitly says to us that Muhammad does not know of anything of the unseen. Now, does that mean Rasulullah doesn't know anything at all? Well, actually not. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to Rasulullah a few instances where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen, and you put 1,000 lines under chosen to report to Rasulullah that knowledge, to give him that knowledge. But before going to these instances, let me tell you about stories where in real life Rasulullah didn't know much of what was going on. For example, when our mother Aisha, as in Surah An-Nur, and Al-Ahzab and all these things, where she was accused of fornication. And the whole story happened that one day Rasulullah ﷺ used to, before going outside, for whatever reason, for war or for business or whatever, he would take one of his wives. So one day before leaving, she borrowed a necklace from her sister, radiallahu anha. This is Aisha, radiallahu anha. Anyway, the story goes that one day she lost her necklace and she couldn't see what it was, and she was looking at it and the whole army was looking for it and they couldn't find it. And neither did Rasulullah. If you knew the unseen, you could have just gone and said, oh, it's there or it's there. But anyway, the story goes that it was under her camel. And also when she was accused of that fornication, for 30 days he didn't know what Aisha radiallahu anha had done. Has she committed that or not? Even at the end of it, he went in the almost like near the end of the month, he went to her and said to her, Ya Aisha, in kunti almamti bi dhanban fastaghfirillah. If you have committed a sin, make repentance to Allah. And she got even angrier than that. And also as Muslims, we all agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa huwa bi kulli shay'in alim, that Allah knows absolutely all things. So if Allah gives to His messenger the knowledge of all things, what's the difference between Allah and the messenger? We have then associated our prophet to Allah, and whoever believes that disbelieves straight away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in countless ayat in Al-Quran has explicitly said that He is the only one who knows all, including the hour. So was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a man who knew all what was hidden at that time? Of course not. Absolutely not. He didn't know what was going to happen to him in the future. Not even the next day. He didn't know when he was going to eat. He didn't know who the hypocrites in Al-Madinah were. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many ayat has told him that they are hypocrites, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't reveal who they were to him, and nobody could do that. وَمِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ مَرَدُوا عَلَى النِّفَاقِ لَا تَعْلَمُهُمْ نَحْنُ نَعْلَمُهُمْ. And of the people of Al-Madinah, there are people that have grown so deeply in hypocrisy. You don't know them. We know them. And this is in Surah At-Tawbah, Ayah 101. So this is explicit. So by saying that Rasulullah ﷺ knows the absent, Al-Ghayb, we are making a huge, big, wrong claim that will deal us the hand of losers in the day of Al-Qiyamah. My dear brothers and my sisters, does it mean that Rasulullah didn't know at all what was going to happen? Of course not. There were times for the necessity to be believed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam few elements of the absent. For example, as we all know, there are many ahadith that speak about the end of the world, the events that are going to happen. For example, nations will gather around the Muslims and they will take our fortunes and everything. And the reason is because we people will become the laziest people on earth. One day, as Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu, and he said, قَامَ فِينا رَسُولَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَقَامًا فَمَا تَرَكَ شَيْئًا يَكُونُ مِنْ مَقَامِهِ ذَلِكَ إِلَى قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ إِلَّا حَدَّثَهُ حَفِظَهُ مَنْ حَفِظَهُ وَنَسِيَهُ مَنْ نَسِيَهُ. رواه البخاري المسلم. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu said that one day Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم stood up a whole day telling them everything that was to happen from that moment there until the end of time. Some people have remembered it or recalled it or kept it or memorized it, while others have not. In another hadith by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, in Sahih Muslim, he said that one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam khataba salla bina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-fajr. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed salat al-fajr. وَصَعَدَ الْمِنْبَرَ فَخَطَبَنَا حَتَّى حَضَرَتْ الظُّهْرِ. So after salat al-fajr, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on the minbar and he gave them a talk, standing up or sitting or whatever. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did give them a talk from salat al-fajr to salat al-dhuhr. فَنَزَلَ فَصَلَّ. Then he came down to pray al-dhuhr. Then he went back again, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the minbar from salat al-dhuhr to salat al-asr. And then he spoke again about the future, what is going to happen. And then when salat al-asr came, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, نَزَلَ فَصَلَّ ثُمَّ خَطَبَنَا حَتَّى غَرُبَتِ الشَّمْسِ. And then he gave them the khutbah until the sun set away. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab says, فَأَخْبَرَنَا بِمَا هُوَ كَائِنْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. So he gave us everything that was to happen until the day of al-qiyamah. فَأَعْلَمُنَا أَحْفَظُنَا. So the people who have memorized a lot are the people who are more knowledgeable. And this is in Muslim. Does that mean that Rasulullah ﷺ told them that in the future there will be someone who will live in the United Kingdom? His name is Abdullah Muhammad. I'm just making up this entity here. He will have every day £5 and he's going to work as a minicab and he will have 3 children and a wife. And no, that is not what he told them, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He told them, for example, about the great events, like the sun rising from the west and all these great Isa alayhi salam, the battles, all those tribulations that we see, the earthquakes, the volcanoes, the problems, the all these things. And how did he know that, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How did that? It's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen few chapters that Allah shows him. And I'll give you an example. Allah does the same thing to us humans today, just like he did for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except with a few other differences. For example, today, let's assume, okay, let's assume you go into a research, you start researching, and you've got an idea in your mind about plane flyings in the sky. Go with me in time where people didn't think that a plane would fly. And even Western physicians and mathematicians never thought and they never believed that one day iron could fly. It just was not a possibility. So much so that there are tons of studies out there that would tell you that back in history, 300 years ago or something like that, the idea of mankind flying was an impossibility. Well, today you can see we can fly in a completely different world. It's completely, totally out of mind. When that idea came in the mind of the person, at that moment there, the person had a vision, and that's what we call a vision. So he saw kind of like he traveled in the future. He pictured in their mind, her or his mind, something flying, and they have an idea, and then they went around and studied and researched and tried and experiments, and people have lost their lives and everything in pursuit to one vision. That vision is the belief in the absent. Even you today, when you want to run a business, you don't just go into the business. You make studies. You start looking into the future, make calculations and everything. And Allah has given you certain elements, factors that you can work with. But it's different. How about if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you now the power to know who your child is going to marry and what children will he or will she have? Isn't that something unbelievable? But that would be just a special treat for you. It doesn't mean you know everything about every other human. Again, in a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this hadith in Sahih Muslim, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله زوالي الأرض. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drew the ends of the world, of the earth, near to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فرأيت مشارقها ومغاربها. And I have seen its eastern parts of the land and the western ends of this land that Allah showed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the dominion of my ummah, i.e. mulk ummah, on what my ummah will possess. And to which extent it would reach. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about certain things that are part of the future. But what is of interest to me here is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this happened to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day when he was in the minbar and he looked as if he was looking very far. And he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is capable of everything. He brought the entire earth and he just spread it right in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's like a time travel. And time travel in the future. So Rasulullah was there and he was seeing, just like we see today in the sci-fi movies, subhanAllah. It's time travel. They show you right in front of you special, we call them special effects. But in reality, your brain can't tell the difference. Go to Star Wars and all those sabers and all those things and how these flies and planes and all these things. How do they happen? They don't exist in reality. It's all computer generated and CGI and all that kind of stuff. So you see, if mankind can do this, if people today, if they want to invest in building a huge building like a whole city, now they have a mock-up designs where they design the whole city exactly like you see it right in front of you. So you actually can see the progress of that project right in front of your eyes, and you actually can see it terminated right in front of your eyes. All you gotta do is put your money and wait a few years, and there it is right in front of you. Why is this kind of acceptable? And that Allah would open the gates of the absent or the unseen to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he showed him certain things that would happen in the future so that mankind believe that he is the true messenger of Allah. How would you believe, you, the listener to me right now, how do you know that Rasulullah spoke the truth? How? Why hasn't he written the Quran out of himself or deputized? It's because of those elements of the unseen, the unfelt, and the unheard, which is called the absent, al-ghayb, were revealed to him. When we see things today, we go, aha, Rasulullah spoke the truth, look at that. And that gives you an oomph in your own belief. So my dear brothers and my sisters, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explicitly also spoken that he doesn't know when the hour will take place. Jibreel alayhi salam, when he came one day to visit him, and when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with the Sahaba in al-Madinah, and Jibreel came and asked about al-Islam, al-Iman, and al-Ihsan. And then he asked him about the hour. حدثني عن الساعة. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, مَسَّائِلُ بِأَعْلَمَ مِنْهَا مِنَ الْمَسْؤُولِ. The mas'ul doesn't know any better than the questioner, i.e. Jibreel. I.e. I don't know when the hour will take place. This is really very explicit. Now, the people who want really to give a status far bigger than that what he deserves, i.e. our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went to a ayah in Surah Al-Jinn. In Surah Al-Jinn, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this here is the problem with this understanding, is they took one ayah or two ayat and they cut them from what was before that and what is after that. The very first thing that we need to pay attention to is this is in Surah Al-Jinn, in the Surah Al-Jinn. Of the attributes of Al-Jinn is people think that Al-Jinn know the unseen, that they can mess up your life and they can do things to you. Even today people, they say, I have magic, I have sihr, I have this. And when their life is messed up, it's because the jinn is acting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specially put this ayah in Surah Al-Jinn so that we mankind can understand that the jinn have absolutely no power about your future, and neither did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam have any power for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Hatta idha ra'aw ma yu'adun," and here he's speaking about the disbelievers or the people who do not believe, until they see that which they are promised, i.e. on the day of al-qiyamah. Follow the ayat with me. فَسَيَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ أَضْعَفُ نَاصِرًا وَأَقَلُّ عَدَدًا. On that day, they will know who is weaker when it comes to support and helpers, and also who is less in numbers. On the day of Qiyamah, you can't beat the angels. Anyway, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ Muhammad, tell them, إِنْ أَدْرِي أَقَارِيبٌ مَا تُعَدُونَ أَمْ يَجْعَلُ لَهُ رَبِّي أَمَدًا. I do not know if what you are promised is near, or if my Rabb, my Lord, will grant it for a long time to take place. And this shows that Rasulullah doesn't know what Allah wants to do with these people. And then to justify this, that Rasulullah cannot give them the piece of information that is going to happen this or then, he said, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ. Allah is the absolute knower of al-ghayb, the absent. فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا. And he does not disclose his ghayb, the knowledge of the unseen, to anyone, except إِلَّا مَنِ ارْتَضَى مِنْ رَسُولٍ, except a messenger that Allah accepts to show him some of the unseen. Just like I said, of all those things that are happening now, when Rasulullah has existed 1400 years ago. And he sees, for example, women, the way they dress, kasiyat and ariyat, they are dressed, but they are undressed, the see-through dress and all these things. And how the cars, when Rasulullah spoke about the cars, all these things were revealed to Rasulullah by choice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah wanted to show him in particular these things that Rasulullah spoke to us about. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنَّهُ يَسْلُكُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ رَصَدًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send before each messenger and behind him special protection. لِيَعْلَمَ أَنْ قَدْ أَبْلَغُوا رِسَالَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ, that he knows that they have conveyed the messages of their Lord to mankind. And subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَحَاطَ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ وَأَحْصَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ عَدَدًا, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything that is with them, and he has enumerated all things in number, i.e. kept it in complete details. They said, you know what? This is an element that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he has taught Rasulullah some of the unseen. Yes, he has, but the Prophet doesn't know all the unseen, and especially the end of the world, or the end of any other worlds, the hour or any other hour, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has dealt with this issue explicitly, but it's mankind subhanallah who refuse to follow tree with the Quran. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 187 and 188. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ, they ask you, Muhammad, like curiosity, when is about the hour? أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا, الْإِرْسَاء, the term إِرْسَاء is when the ship gets in the harbor and throws the anchor. That means it has finally arrived to its destination. مُرْسَاهَا here, as if the hour is a ship traveling to us and it has finally thrown its anchor and it is imminent, it's going to happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, the answer to give them is, إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي. إِنَّمَا لِلْحَصَرِ, the only one, the only part of knowledge about it is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا يُجَلِّيهَا لِوَقْتِهَا, a tajliya is when you uncover something that is hidden. So, only Allah will uncover it when its time is due. The hour and what's going to happen and the events of it and everything that concerns the hour is such a heavy burden in the heavens and in earth. It's the end of the everything. It's such a huge event. Look at you when you lose your brother or your mother or your son or your husband or your wife. Like it's your world has ended. People fall out of love when the marriage is broken. They say, my world has crumbled down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says then a reality, لَا تَأْتِيكُمْ إِلَّا بَغْتَ, the hour will not come upon you except as an element of surprise, and no human on earth knows exactly. Now someone might say, because there are some people who say, all the signs, all the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, when he speaks about the signs of the hour, are irrelevant because Al-Quran says, لَا تَأْتِيكُمْ إِلَّا بَغْتَ, it will only happen to you unexpectedly. Well, there is an explanation to that. And this is how it goes. Let's assume the hour, the end of the world, is cancer third degree, where the person is certainly going to die. We know with what Allah has given us of knowledge that are certain signs, once they all are apparent and they're clear and they have really become fulfilled, it means the cancer is approaching and the person, the further those signs go deeper and become more apparent, the clearer the end is near. Well, exactly, but we don't know exactly when the person is going to die. Many people were told by doctors that you're going to die in 2 months, and people are still alive until today. And many people, doctors have said, oh, no big deal, it's not a problem, and the people died a week later. So yes, you can see here, even though we have the signs, even though we have those explicit evidences where Allah has revealed the unseen or the absent to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ghayb, Allah has not given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the knowledge of the hour, exactly when. It's out of curiosity, we do have some scholars like Suyuti, Ali rahmatullah, and many other people that have gotten into calculation, and some people have calculated of the Muslim scholars, I'm telling you, it's not like Christians or other people. We have Islamic books in our heritage where scholars like Imam Suyuti, Ali rahmatullah, one of the great scholars, have actually tried to work out when the hour was, and they did some researches and some things like that, and they said it's going to happen on that day with that date and everything, and absolutely wrong and nonsense of what they said. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala carry on and says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ, they ask you, كَأَنَّكَ حَفِيٌّ بِهَا, as if you had a special relationship with it, as if you knew something about it that no other person knows. And what Allah is saying here is you don't know. You are just like any other human. They ask you as if you are familiar with it, when it's going to happen. They ask you as if you were thoroughly acquainted with it, that you know everything about it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, قُلْ, answer them. إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. And that says, إِنَّمَا أَدَتُ حَصَرْ, it's the only thing certainly, specifically, surely, without any doubt, the sole knowledge of it is with Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, but the majority of people do not know. And here is the calamity. They said, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, they said, but he didn't tell him, but you don't know. But Allah said, but the majority of people do not know, which means that you, Muhammad, know. But this is absolutely the wrong, evil understanding. You go Ibn Jarir Tabari and all the books of tafsir, it's between the scholars, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, i.e. the majority of people do not know that only Allah has the absolute knowledge about the other hour and nobody else. Tons of people do not know this reality, and tons of people think that somebody else might know and some calculation might lead us to the hour. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, the majority of people do not know that the only one who knows the hour is Allah and no other human at all. And then right after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لَا أَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِي نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. Ya Muhammad, tell to these people that I have absolutely no power of benefit or hurt to myself except what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides for me and wills for me and has created for me. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ, hypothetically speaking, وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ, and if I had the knowledge of the ghayb, the unseen, the absent of the future, لَسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءِ, I should have secured for myself an abundance of wealth, and no ever, never, ever, and no evil should have touched me. إِنْ أَنَا إِلَّا نَذِيرٌ وَبَشِيرٌ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ, I am nothing but a human being who is a warner and a bringer of good news to the people who believe. So when you look at all these evidences and everything of that, how can a human being claim that our Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew the absolute unseen? Anyone who claims that, it must be explained to him and provided all the evidences and open his mind and explain and debate and hope that he would get to the idea that nobody knows about the unseen except Allah, the absolute here, I'm meaning, then that's fine. But if they insist that Allah has taught our Prophet special knowledge and it became just like between Rasulullah and Allah. This knowledge, my dear brothers and my sisters, leads to disbelief. I'm not saying they are disbelievers, because there are some people who came into the world that they don't know any better, and these people, they need to be explained to that what they believe in is wrong. So how did this understanding make its way to the Muslims of today? It really started from a group called Al-Ismailiyya, or in other terminologies they refer to Al-Batiniyya, the internalists, or hiddenists, as you will see in a minute. Al-Ismailiyya are a group from a Shia. The Shia, at the very beginning, they were all one united entity. Except they said that the leader who's going to succeed the father should be also the son of the imam. And so it went on and on until they got to somebody called Ja'far al-Sadiq. Ja'far al-Sadiq had a son named Ismail ibn Ja'far al-Sadiq. This young Ismail, who was about to become the next leader, the next imam, died. His father then organized for him a funeral. Now what the people say is that when the son died, he actually didn't die, but his father, Ja'far al-Sadiq, has faked a funeral so that the people of the Dawla al-Abbasiyya, the Abbasiyyun at that moment there, who were killing the Umayyin and other people, wouldn't kill him. And the people said that his father, Ja'far al-Sadiq, had faked his death so that the people wouldn't kill him and that Ismail is alive. And since that time there, the idea of Al-Islam, Al-Quran, and Sunnah, the historical events and everything have double meaning, an external meaning or the shown meaning, and that is what you and I know. And they have an internal and hidden meaning that the only special people that have won the pleasure of Allah and the closeness status to Allah would be and would receive this special knowledge. The Sufis today use the same things. Iran today and the Shia use the same things, and that's why they make their imams as sinless and people don't make a mistake, and whatever a sheikh in Iran says, people believe him because of this knowledge that the sheikh has an internal knowledge, only him is known or has been taught it by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and only the sheikh can relate it to his followers. And this is causing great abuse in the ignorant world today, in the Sufis, with the Shia and everything. Al-Batiniyya or Al-Ismailiyya. From these people came the belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in codes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Allah says something like this here, وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, but the majority of people don't know, they say, but actually what he means is, you do know, Ya Muhammad, but the majority of people don't know. And this is an absolutely voice of a shaitan. This is wrong. This is absolutely wrong. So to close my talk here about, does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam know the unseen? As I explained earlier on at the beginning, the matter of the unseen, the ghayb or the absent, is of three types. There is the past, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken about it. And when he spoke about Fir'aun and other prophets, Musa, Ibrahim, Adam, and all these things, they are part of the absent, and Allah revealed them to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran. Even us today, when we speak about the creation of Adam, for example, to a Jewish or Christian, to an atheist, we are telling them about the absent, the unseen. And this we share with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no problem. There is also the absent which takes place right now, as I gave an example of your neighbors, what they are doing right now, or what your heart is doing right now, or the oxygen that you are breathing now, what it is doing, only is known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah has not given this to any other person. And the third one is the absent of the future, about what's going to happen. And this is here, as I said, there are certain things that only apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and no other human can have. No other human, from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam until Adam alayhi salam, until virtually any other person here. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ, the knower of the absent, the unseen, فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ, and Allah will not reveal his absent or the unseen, what he has kept hidden, to any human out there. This is why at the end of Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. إِنَّ, here in this ayah, in English they translate indeed, but in Arabic it's harfu ta'kid. Harf ta'kid, i.e. it's a preposition that is used to emphasize a meaning. And it is also a preposition to remove doubt. When I say it is only, this is what inna here means. It is only Allah that possesses the knowledge about when the hour will take place. The knowledge, the whole, what goes on about the hour, the exact time, the exact day, who's going to be alive at that moment there, what's going to happen exact, is only known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here, not indeed, it is indeed Allah alone who has knowledge of the hour. This doesn't mean that, okay, I'm telling you this here, but really in reality, Muhammad also knows. Anyone who believes this, وَلَعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, it's such a huge act of disbelief. So, إِنَّ اللَّهِ, it is indeed only Allah that knows about the knowledge of the hour. وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ, and it is only Allah who sends down the rain. And it is only Allah who knows what is in the wombs at a certain level where mankind cannot know. And no soul shall perceive, or no soul would perceive what it will earn tomorrow. And no soul perceives in what land it will die. Very indeed, it is only Allah who is Alimun Khabir, who knows it all and is acquainted with everything to happen. After this one here, anyone that says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows the unseen, that only Allah knows, has lied. And has, as our mother Aisha radiallahu anha said, مَنْ حَدَّثَكَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ فَقَدْ كَذَبْ. Whoever tells you that Muhammad knows the absent, the unseen, is a liar. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the true knowledge about this beautiful Islam and to put Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam right where he belongs. And where he belongs is what he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the beginning, لَا تُطْرُونِي كَمَا أَطَارَتِ النَّصَارَ ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ. Do not exaggerate in overpraising me as the Christians praise the son of Mary. فَإِنَّمَا أَنَا عَبْدُهُ. I am nothing but his subservient, his abd. Therefore, call me the subservient of Allah, Abdullah wa Rasuluh, and his messenger. And this is why in the tashahud, you say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has got a status. We love him, he's a messenger of Allah, but Allah remains Allah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came as a messenger of Allah so that he helps us go back to Allah, worship him, because we are human. And humans can only take information from humans. If Allah sent us a prophet, as a messenger, as an angel, or as a jinn, we would never have done what we can do today. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we all will believe the true belief. And if you have any questions, please do get back to me. My name is Abdusalam Abu Hanifa. My telephone number is 078-7640-8735. This is for the United Kingdom. If you are abroad, just add 0044. And also, you can send me a message on WhatsApp to join my group, and you are most welcome to do so and ask questions, or go on YouTube and run a search by Islam Pep Talks, and you should get to my channel out there. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the right guidance, bless our hearts, open our minds, and as usual, open your Muslim mind. There is intelligence in it. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله and Allah knows more. السلام عليكم.